All glory, praise and honour to our Lord Jesus. Hello and welcome to Northcliffe Union Church. We trust your time with us today is blessed. A reminder to those of you who use the NUC library, please ensure you sign your books back into the register when you return them to the library, and please don't leave them with the janitors. You're encouraged to join Pastor Gavin at the 6 p.m. service on Pentecost Sunday for a not-to-be-missed question and answer session around Pentecost and the Holy Spirit for living in today's world. If you'd like to join via Zoom, please email Andrew on andrew@nuchurch.org.za. Have you done your grocery shopping yet? Our food parcel ministry need tinned food, cleaning products and toiletries to help make up the food parcels that we give to those in our body who are in need. Bless you and thank you for helping when you can.
There is no darkness too great that your love cannot overtake. There is no stronghold too strong that your love cannot tear it down. There is a hope that's alive. I feel it burning on the inside. There is a blood that's overcome. King of kings, let your kingdom come. Let every heart, let every soul praise you, Lord. All of the earth, all of creation praise your name. Let every heart, let every soul praise you, Lord. All of the earth, all of creation, praise your name. You are the God who restores. With just one word, the world was formed. You are the
the Spirit whose light is breaking forth like the dawn from night. You are the one who holds the keys, and every battle is your victory. Yours is the blood that's overcome. O King of Kings, let your kingdom come. Let every heart, let every soul praise you, Lord. All of the earth, all of creation praise your name. Let every heart, let every soul praise you, Lord. All of the earth, all of creation praise your name. Oh, we praise your name. Sing your praise, hallelujah. We praise your name, hallelujah. We sing your praise, hallelujah. So let every heart, let every soul praise you. All of the earth, all of creation, praise your name. Oh, let every heart, let every soul praise you, Lord. All of the earth, all of creation, praise your name. We praise your name. Sing your praise, hallelujah. We praise your name, hallelujah. We sing your praise, hallelujah. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
From the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name. Good morning and welcome to Northcliffe Union Church Online. We have been on a journey over the last few weeks looking at the Ascension, and on Thursday morning, on the 13th of May, we came together and celebrated that glorious reality. And it was great to know that in our community of churches, a number of churches spent time, set aside some time, and one church in particular set aside the day for a retreat just to dwell on the glory and the reality of the Ascension. And what we've recognized in this time is that we suffer from ascension deficit disorder. We have underemphasized, overlooked, ignored the Ascension, the glorious reality of the Ascension of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that impacts our faith. That impacts our daily living. Someone has called the fact that we've neglected the Ascension the forgotten fundamental. You know, like anything in life, there are certain fundamental skills that we need, whether we're driving a car, riding a bicycle, fixing something at home. There are certain fundamentals that need to be observed to keep us safe and get the job done effectively. When we neglect those, everything goes pear-shaped. And when we forget the fundamental reality of the Ascension of Christ, when it is not front of mind in our hearts and our lives and in our behavior, there is something sadly lacking in our Christianity and our understanding of the fully comprehensive, glorious message of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. So let's spend some more time today dealing with this ascension deficit disorder. And I want to share today some keys to living ascension-shaped lives. How does the ascension impact us? How does it change the way we think? How does it change the way we behave? And what does an ascension-shaped life look like? Patrick Schreiner goes so far as to say that without the ascension, Christ's work is incomplete. Without the ascension, a huge hole stands in the story. Without the ascension, other biblical teachings become skewed or are seen out of context and out of proportion. So the first key I want to share with you today about living ascension-shaped lives is that we need to learn to focus on causes and not symptoms. You know, so much in our life is dealing with symptoms. We get indigestion, runny noses, headaches, and we take medication for that. And if we read the packaging, we'll see that it talks about for symptomatic relief of a headache, for symptomatic relief of indigestion. It doesn't actually deal with the cause of that indigestion. I mean, I know somebody who takes in copious amounts of soda bicarb every day, trying to deal with indigestion. But if they just changed their diet, they wouldn't be chugging down these piles of soda, bicarbonate soda all the time. We need to deal with causes. And in life, we are so distracted by symptoms that we don't deal with causes. And the challenges we face on a daily basis, things that are going on in our lives, like finance and stress, and anger, and immorality that is so rampant in our society, substance abuse, these are all symptoms of a problem. They're not the problem. So giving someone a hard time about being a substance abuser, whether it's alcohol or drugs or whatever it might be, that is not going to help, because that's dealing with the symptom rather than the cause. We have to get down to the actual reality of what is going on. Otherwise, our lives will not change. We will be guilty of what Dr. Dallas Willard calls the gospel of sin management. We try to be nicer people. Don't be angry. Be polite. Be kind. What is the cause of my anger or my lack of politeness or kindness? Why do I get so worked up in the traffic with bad driving, forgetting many times that my driving's not great either? We need to get down to the causes, and that's what the gospel does. And we have to accept that living in a fallen, broken world is going to mean that we are going to be confronted by the symptoms of the fallen, broken world all around us in the lives of other people and even in our own lives. Let's pick our fights. Let's fight the right battles in terms of Christ-likeness and holiness and victorious Christian living. And I'm going to read a passage of scripture to you that might seem a little bit obscure or cryptic in this context. But listen as I read from Acts chapter 3, verses 19 to 23. Excuse me. Peter says, "Repent then and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord, and that he may send the Christ who has been appointed for you, even Jesus. He must remain in heaven until the time comes for God to restore everything, as he promised long ago through his holy prophets. For Moses said, 'The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own people. You must listen to everything he tells you.'" Moses, thousands of years before Christ, preparing the way, prophesying about the coming of the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. "You must listen to everything he tells you. Anyone who does not listen to him will be completely cut off from among his people." So why am I reading this passage? What does this mean? Well, we're told to repent and turn to God so that our sins may be wiped out, so that we will deal with the challenges we face in our life, the things that block our fellowship and our relationship with God and with each other. Because the scripture says, if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, as God is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. So let's recognize that we're fallen, broken people, and that we need Christ, and that in the cross, in his death, his burial, his resurrection, and his ascension, he has dealt fully and finally with our brokenness. Now, that doesn't seem like a reality in the here and now, because we're stuck in time. But the way that we're seen from a biblical perspective is we are seen to be saints. We're seen to be blameless. We're seen to be the holy people of God. And so we need to live now, in the here and now, in light of who we've been declared to be, in light of the finished work of Christ on the cross and his return to the place of highest honor and glory in heaven. He must remain in heaven, verse 21 says, until the time comes for God to restore everything. So as things are in, they are being restored, but we are living in a fallen, broken world. So when we say, "What is your problem? What is wrong with you?" The problem, your problem, is the same as my problem. We're fallen and broken. Let's not be distracted by symptoms. Let's recognize the cancer of sin that eats away at our lives and takes us away from the beauty and the glory and the wonder of loving Jesus. And just like any disease, whether it's cancer or COVID or anything else, there are certain telltale signs, there are symptoms that indicate a problem, but they themselves are not the problem. And it's not about resigning ourselves to the brokenness. It's not about giving up. It's about knowing that there will come a time, that glorious, glorious time at the end of the ages, when, as the scripture says, he will restore all things. And so in the fallen, broken world we live in, as we deal with our own brokenness, we live in hope, we live in expectation. But we mustn't try and modify our behavior without transforming our belief by the word of God. Let's stop treating symptoms like causes. Even on a package of headache tablets, it'll say, "Don't take continuously for more than 10 days, and if your headache continues for longer than see a doctor, see a physician, because there is something greater that is wrong. There's something more significant. There's something at a deeper level. And I love this quote. I don't know who said it, but they said, and in the light of the return of Christ, in the light of the fact that God is in the process of restoring all things, they say everything will be all right in the end. If it's not all right, it's not the end. Everything will be all right in the end. If it's not all right, it's not the end. And so the situation in which we find ourselves is a constant reminder of our need of Christ and the hope with which we should live of his return and of the restoration of all things. And in the meantime, we need to be at work healing and helping the hurting, dealing with our own hurt and helping others who are hurting. There's a wonderful story I want to share with you a bit later. I hope I don't forget it, because it's an incredible story. So firstly, first key to living ascension-shaped lives is focus on causes, not symptoms. Let's recognize sin in ourselves, recognize sin in other people. We're not called to be judgmental. We're not called to be holier than thou, but we need to recognize we're being restored. And let's not be distracted by symptoms. Let's find the cause, and the cause is always sin. The second key to living an ascension-shaped life is to focus on the permanent, not the temporary. Stop focusing and treating the temporary like it's permanent. This podium, this pulpit, is temporary. This building is temporary. It might stand for hundreds of years, and I certainly hope it does. But it's not going to stand forever. And the easiest way to distinguish the permanent from the temporary is that things we can see are temporary and things we can't see are permanent. So spiritual realities are permanent. Physical things are temporary. And how tragic that so many Christians spend so much time hoarding and gathering and collecting and then sorting and then storing in storage facilities temporary things. They're not permanent. We spend so much time accumulating junk, and then we have to insure that junk, and that gets expensive. And there's stuff everywhere. We trip over it in our homes. We think the permanent is that which is visible. We look for comfort and consolation and satisfaction in stuff rather than finding our contentment and our hope and our anchor in the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's tragic to see how many Christians are pursuing the lives of people who are lost celebrities, who know no better, who are egocentric, narcissistic, dysfunctional people, and Christians are chasing after them and defending them in front of other people when they're not the leaders. They're confused. They're lost. And so we want to live lives like them and have what they have. Why do you think sports companies get sports celebrities to endorse products? Because we're such suckers, we see that if somebody we look up to has that kind of watch or those kind of shoes or that perfume or that cologne, oh, we must get that because they have it. We act like lemmings. We follow the crowd because we are focusing on the temporary and not the permanent. Listen to the words of Jesus in Matthew chapter 6. These are well-known words. Very well-known words to us, but we've not yet taken them to heart because we're not living them out. Jesus says in Matthew 6, verse 19, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." If we go across to verse 25, Jesus says again, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you'll eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to his life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow? They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today, and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added or given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. We should all be shouting at the TV screen or their cell phone screen, amen to that. Let's focus on the permanent and not the temporary. And as I said, it's not very complicated to identify the difference. Everything we can see is temporary. Things we can't see are permanent. And when Jesus says, seek first the kingdom of God, he's not talking about some ideal in the future. He's talking about the reign of Christ in the here and now. Seek the reign of Christ in your life. Surrender to Christ the King. Stop following people and fearing people and worrying about what might or might not happen. But as first priority, seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And these things, the context is all the things we worry about. Does worrying help? Has it ever helped me? Besides giving me an ulcer? No. But we must trust the Lord, surrender to him, and celebrate him. And in that way, our lives will radiate the reality of his presence within us, the work of his Spirit. You see, we're not called, we're not expected to do this by ourselves. We could never do it by ourselves. We are enabled to do it by the work of the Holy Spirit within us. He wants everything that God wants for us, obviously, because he's God, the Holy Spirit. And so he enables us. He empowers us. It's not that these things are difficult to do. They are humanly impossible to do. But we have the Holy Spirit. And what we remember at Ascension, as we look forward to Pentecost, which is just around the corner, is that Jesus said, I will send you the Comforter, I will send you the Counselor, who will remind you of everything I've taught you, and who will enable you, who will equip you, who will empower you. And so Paul celebrates in Romans, if the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, and that's true in the life of every Christian, every believer, he will energize you, he will quicken you, he will empower you to do what God desires we should do, because we will be in the process of being transformed into who God wants us to be. And God's not a dictator. He's not some crazy warlord. He's our heavenly Father. He's our how much more Father, as Jesus describes him in the same chapter in the Gospel of Matthew. So we need to be intentional about recognizing the difference between that which is temporary and that which is permanent. And I'm not trying to sell you something that's not true. I want to show you, I want to express to you, it's the best way to live. And your burden is so much lighter because you're resting in the peace that passes understanding. You're responding to the call of Jesus, come to me all who are burdened and weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. You will find rest for your soul. Take my yoke upon you. Learn from me, for I'm gentle and humble in heart. That is what lies before us. That's the beauty of living the ascension-shaped life. And following on from that, thirdly, the third key to living ascension-shaped lives is to focus on service, not on profit and popularity. How many times do we recognize the people around us who are doing menial tasks? How many times do the cleaners in Cresta get acknowledged and greeted by people? They're invisible to us for most of the time. And we don't want to be involved in that kind of service because then we're going to be invisible. We want to be recognized. We want to be thanked. We want to be affirmed. But Jesus calls us to service. By the way, make a point of greeting these wonderful people around us that are cleaning up our mess. Let's acknowledge them. Let's praise them. Let's thank them. But the picture is one of when you get involved in service, you become invisible. And it's not popular today. Everybody wants to be recognized. Everybody wants their patch of sunshine. Everybody wants their 15 seconds of fame. But we're called to serve. The Son of Man, we're told in Mark's gospel. Jesus himself did not come to be served, but to serve and give himself, give his life as a ransom for many. And we've got to go look at Philippians 2 again. This is such a dense passage of scripture. It's so comprehensive. It's so rich in biblical truth. And again, these words may be familiar to us, but have we really embraced this truth and are we living it out enabled by the Spirit of God? Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, something to be held on to as if he was going to lose it. But he made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, actually taking the very nature of a slave, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. Just an ordinary first century AD peasant, God in the flesh. Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. That's supreme humiliation. And that's followed by supreme exaltation. But as we saw on Thursday morning, as we gathered to celebrate the event of the ascension of Christ, we're reminded that there's no crown without the cross. And that's what this text brings about so powerfully. He became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. You know, sometimes when we read scripture, we read it so superficially that we don't appreciate, even in the slightest, the impact, the gravity of what scripture is telling us. We must recognize that we will never be able to comprehend the abject, supreme, complete humiliation of God taking on human form taking on the form of a slave, taking on the form of the invisible cleaner at Cresta. Not recognized, ignored, left to clean up other people's mess. And even that is a pathetic attempt to try to explain what Jesus went through in leaving the glory of heaven and coming into a sin-soaked, sick, fallen, broken world. And if you're saying, hey, hang on, Gavin, you're very negative about this. The world is beautiful. It's beautiful because we don't know how broken it is. If we could compare the world in which we live to the world that God created before the fall, we would recognize we're living in a sewer. And so it's a matter of contrast and comparison. It's very relative. And yes, there's beauty all around us, but it's beautiful because our eyes have never seen what true beauty actually is. But Jesus knows that because he is the center of worship and praise in heaven. That's what the revelation tells us. And he humbled himself and he came to live in this broken, war-torn, scarred, the smoldering wreckage of humanity, the aftermath of the fall and the entry of sin into the world as it's recorded in Genesis chapter 3. And many today still don't recognize him. Many today use the name of Jesus as an exclamation point or as a word of cursing and horror. And it's the most beautiful name. It's the most glorious name any human ear has ever heard. But you see, he came to serve. And he laid that aside. And if we're going to live ascension-shaped lives, if we're going to live lives that honor the glory of God in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, the God-man, we must focus on service and not profit and not popularity. And before we rush to say, oh, that's not me, we need to just think. Take some time to reflect. How upset do I get when people don't recognize what I've done? When I'm not thanked? When I'm not affirmed? Perry and Perry, in their book on the ascension, speaking of this, they say, this means that the best place to look for the truth of the ascension is in the community that lives in the truth on the cross. It's a picture of the body of Christ being willing to suffer, to serve people, and spread the gospel, and share Jesus. You know, we're familiar with the reality of suffering in the church around the world, our persecuted brothers and Christians. And I read just a couple days ago, 4 more believers beheaded in Indonesia by Muslim extremists. And then yesterday I read a statistic that's absolutely horrific. Nigerian Islamic jihadists have massacred, in the first 4 months of 2021, they've massacred 1,470 Christians. And 2,200 Christians have been abducted in that same time period. And we look at this, and we look at suffering, and we say, where is God? This is not what I signed up for. Well, my dear friend, if that's not what you signed up for when you heard the gospel, you didn't hear the gospel. You heard something else. You heard false promises and man-made religion. But the glorious irony in these tragedies, speaking in the context of service, is the greatest service, the highest service any Christian can render, is to give themselves for the cause of the gospel and in the name of Christ. And what these madmen, what these terrified, pitiful madmen do not realize when they behead Christians and rape Christian women and torture and burn and starve and beat to death Christians, what they do not realize is that in their evil, they are furthering the message of the cross. They're not killing the message of the cross. They're not stamping out the name of Jesus like so many have tried to do in human history. They're actually furthering the message of the cross, because the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. And so the highest act of Christian service, which is so far from removed from our comfort zone Christianity, from our profit-based, popularity-based Christianity, the highest form of Christian service is to give our lives for Jesus. There's no life that dies in the name of Jesus is a waste. It projects and propels the gospel message further into the darkness. And if we're going to be any heavenly good, if we're going to live ascension-shaped lives, these are glorious truths that we must embrace. And in this context, let me just point this out, that the ascension is all about Jesus seated on the throne, reigning over all of creation, time and eternity. But my friend, there's a time when Jesus is not seated on that throne, and it's when one of his children dies for him, dies in his name. We see that in the stoning of Stephen in Acts chapter 8. He says, I see heaven open, and I see Christ standing at the right hand of the Father. Jesus stands to honor the King of Kings, seated on the eternal throne, stands to honor every single life that lives in sacrifice and surrender for him and the spreading of the gospel, whether that life is taken by violent evil or whether it's lived as offered as a living sacrifice every single day. This is the message of the gospel, and this is our calling to live ascension-shaped lives and to serve, and not to be seen, not to be recognized, to be overlooked, to take the bowl and the towel in the picture of John 13 where Jesus washed the feet of the disciples and kneel at the stinky, dirty feet of disciples who at that point still didn't even recognize who he truly was. And to wash feet, and to clean wounds, and to shed tears with those who grieve and are hurting. Listen to what Perry and Perry say again. Unparalleled opportunities for gracious and lavish cruciform or cross-shaped love present themselves in our world once we are shaped by the ascension. The world sees disaster, futility, epidemic, and danger. In light of the ascension, Christians see victories. Now let me tell that story I referred to earlier. I've used it before, but it's such an amazing story, and it relates so powerfully to our current context in terms of the epidemic, or the pandemic of COVID-19. There are many plagues that swept the ancient world. One was called the plague of Galen. Galen was a doctor, a physician, who identified and sought to treat this epidemic, a pandemic in the Roman world. It was smallpox, and it was brought back into the Roman Empire by the soldiers returning from all the battles and the conquests, coming back into Roman life, and they brought with them the smallpox, which ravaged the Roman Empire. Actually was part of the downfall of the Roman Empire. It took place between 165 AD and 180 AD. And this physician Galen fled the city to get away, and he was called back into service to help with this disease. But one of the characteristics of the smallpox plague, the plague of Galen, and or the Antonine Plague, named after the emperor at the time, you can look this all up, it's all readily available online. What was characteristic and what was recorded by non-Christians about this time, that was when all the nobility and all the wealthy were fleeing out of the cities in the Roman Empire to get away from the death and disease and the stench of decomposing human flesh, the church was recognized and identified because they were the ones that were pouring into the death and destruction. They were the ones going in to care for the dying and to treat them. And many Christians contracted the disease and died. But it stands out in history as a triumph of the Christian church, living ascension-shaped lives and honoring Jesus and being willing to give their lives for the sake of those who were dying from this horrific disease. And they understood this far less than we even understand COVID-19. Now, how are we responding to the COVID-19 pandemic? Are we staying away from people because we're afraid that we might get sick? That it might be an inconvenience? Maybe we'll die? The best thing that can happen to a Christian is that we die. It's not the worst thing. The worst thing that can happen to a Christian is that we don't live an ascension-shaped life. We live a selfish, self-centered, narcissistic, materialistic life, and we waste our lives. That's the worst thing that can happen to a Christian. But to die in the name of Christ when we're caring for and serving people suffering from this disease, that in biblical terms, friends, that in the kingdom of God is not a tragedy. That's a victory. And that's the life to which we've been called. And so there are opportunities all around us. We've got Stanton, Michelle, and Michelle doing amazing work at the Fairlands Police Station. Join them in that ministry. God is opening up doors there, left, right, and center. There is opportunity everywhere. If we say, oh, there's no opportunity, I don't know what to do for Jesus, that just means we are not in step with Jesus, and we don't see what's going on in God's world because we're focusing on the temporary and not the permanent. We are called to live ascension-shaped lives. And may we, as the people of God, rise up and truly become the church of the Lord Jesus Christ and live lives that honor the sacrifice of Christ and celebrate the victory of Christ now and forever. Father, how we thank you for your word. We thank you for the way that your word, like that scalpel, cuts deep into our souls and identifies the brokenness that is so prevalent. Thank you, Lord, that you don't leave us like that. Thank you that you're in the business, the wonderful work of restoring all things, including our lives, restoring our humanity, restoring our passion, restoring our energy and our ability, enabled by the Holy Spirit, to live lives that acknowledge, that celebrate you and all you are and all you've done. Lord, we pray for your church in this community and in this city, Johannesburg, South Africa. Lord, how history will tell, history will record whether we responded to you or reacted to the circumstances of this pandemic. May we be those that rejoice because we've been given the privilege of suffering and dying for Jesus, for from you and through you and to you are all things. To God be the glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.